Here we're going to see how our data is distributed, and visually we're going to be able to see the shape that its histogram makes, and specifically we're going to be looking at normal distributions and how they're going to be helpful to us. Now, you've probably seen or heard of normal distributions before. It's kind of that standard bell-shaped curve it's described as, and it often occurs in nature. So oftentimes grading is on a normal curve, but things we measure in nature like tree height or people's heights or things like that fall along a normal distribution. So we're going to revisit what we looked at last week, or data that we looked at last week, which came from that answer set, which was looking at the stature or the height of men in the military along with other measurements here. So I want to load that into my workspace. So stature, I'm going to call ST. It's in that Excel file, so I have to use XLS read, and the name is answermen.xlsx. And remember, I have to tell it which cells to use. So if I go to that actual sheet, we see in this kind of stripped down version that from A2 to A1775 are my stature measurements for all of those individuals. So if I go back into MATLAB, I want to go from A2 to A1775. And I need to finish that. So if I load this, this is going to load all of those stature measurements into my workspace. Remember, this was in millimeters, how tall each of the, in this case, 1,774 men was. And I want to, I can start by visualizing this data so I can make a histogram. To choose the number of bins, I can use the various rules that we looked at. I'm going to use Sturgis's rule for this. So my number of bins n, I'm going to take the ceiling of the 2 log of the number of elements I have and add 1 to it. So according to Sturgis's rule, I should be using 12 bins for this much data. So now if I make my histogram of stature and I sort it into n bins, I get my kind of rough first pass as to how the data looks. And let me add grid lines to this so we can get a little bit better idea of what's happening. Opening my figure. All right, so we see that the stature is between 1500 and 2000. Add some X labels to this. And I do want to look at a normalized histogram for this data. So I need to get out from here my X values and the count. And then I can use bar CX. Can tighten it up a little bit. And again, looking at my histogram, but I see it's still in frequency, not relative frequency. So it says 460 men had statures between these two bin edges. So what I want to do is divide X by sum of X, or how many people were sampled in here, so I can get relative frequency or as a percentage. So now I see about 26-27% of the men fell in this category, and then as we go to smaller statures, then less and less of a percentage fall in those bins. As we get to very tall people, fewer and fewer go into those bins. So it looks visually, just from what we know about that bell-shaped curve, that the mean is very high and then the tails are smaller, that visually this might be normally distributed. And what's the advantage if data is normally distributed? Well, that means that I'm going to save the mean of my data into a variable m, and into s I'm going to store the standard deviation of my data. With these two values alone, I can do a lot of prediction of how many people, how many, in this case, men, are going to fall below certain heights or above certain heights with just, again, the mean and the standard deviation alone. So the mean height I found was about 1,756 millimeters, and the standard deviation, or the spread, 66.8. And we'll look a little bit more at how the standard deviation is going to affect this when we look at normal variable or random variables in a little bit. So I'm going to pull up the histogram again. Again, get an idea of this general bell-shaped curve that we're seeing. And then in contrast, I just want to see a data set that is not going to be bell-shaped. So let me just make kind of an artificial data set here. I'll call it capital Q. And let me just make it something like this. Right, so Q is just numbers from 1 to 90. And now if I look at a histogram of Q, I see that clearly this is very different. This is what we would call a uniform distribution. So an equal percentage of numbers fall between 1 and 10, or 0 and 10, 10 and 20, 20 and 30, etc. So all the bins are equally likely to contain that data. So this is much different than what we saw with our stature data. Bringing that back up, we're more likely to find values near the mean than we are to find values further from the mean. And that spread, that standard deviation, is how quickly it kind of dies out as we get away further and further from the mean. But from that other data that we saw, let me bring back Q. We see here that the mean of Q is 45.5, right in the center here. But as we get further and further away, we're just as likely to have values further from the mean as we are close to the mean. So very generally, that's how we can categorize or a characterization of a normal distribution. It's not unique to a normal distribution, but that is the case in a normal distribution. So the first thing we want to do is see, can we treat this as a normal distribution? And what we can use, there's a bunch of different tests, the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test. We're going to use the Lilliefors test to test to see if this data can be treated as a normal distribution or coming from a normal distribution. So what we can use is this function Lilly test, and we can put our stature data into it. And this is going to give us two outputs. Very succinctly, what it's doing is it's testing if we can really disprove that this is a normal, that this comes from a normal distribution. So what we're going to get out of this is H, which is going to be a binary. It's going to be 0 or it's going to be 1. And we're going to get a significance value or a p-value associated with it. So let's see for this data what we get. We get here H is 0 and we get P is 0.14. So the way we can interpret this Lilly test, and it's similar for other sorts of normality tests, is that really we're testing, can we disprove that this comes from a normal distribution? So the 0 tells us we cannot disprove it comes from a normal distribution. So it gives evidence, or it suggests, that it does come from a normal distribution. So the thing to remember here is that when H is 0, we can generally treat it as a normal distribution. If we get H is equal to 1, we generally cannot treat it as though it came from a normal distribution. So we see again, we have H is 0, and we have a p-value. If the p-value is greater than 0.05, then H will be 0. If P is less than 0.05, H will be 1. So this suggests that we can treat this stature data as normally distributed. Now, why this is useful, if you've taken a statistics class before, is that for normally distributed data, again, the mean and the standard deviation are enough to make predictions about where certain percentiles are. We don't have to have the actual data anymore to make these predictions. We don't have to use quantile, but we can use what's called norm CDF. So what we can do here is make a prediction of what percentage of the population in general is going to be below a certain value. All right, so looking at this stature here, let's just look at 1700 millimeters. So that's below average. So I want to make a prediction, what percent of the population is below 1700? I have to put in, that's my kind of cutoff point. The mean is M and the standard deviation is S. So if I run this, this is telling me that according to that mean and that standard deviation from my sample, then my population, I should find that 20% of men are below 1700 millimeters or 1.7 meters tall. So 20% are below that height. Now, let's look at someone taller here. So let's just say like 1875. So again, as a percentage, 96% of the male population is shorter than 1875 millimeters. So again, that lies right around here in my picture. Again, make this bigger one more time. So if I want to know what percentage of the population would be taller than that, well, since the total area under my normalized histogram, which is what I did here by dividing by the total number of samples I have, since I know the total area is 1, the area, my prediction of the area between 0 and 1875 was 90.9628. So that means that it has to add up to 1 in total. So 1 minus that must be the area under my curve that is larger than 1875. So that represents, again, this area kind of over here. So according to that, 3.72% of the male population is taller than 1875 millimeters. We're going to see that if we can treat things as normally distributed, it also helps us when coming up with random numbers that we'll look at in the next section. All right, so this was for that stature data. We showed that we could treat it as being normally distributed, but let's go back to what we looked at before in that kind of sample data that we had been working with previously. So let me get rid of all of this and just go back to my L05 sample. Okay, so these are again those same 100 data points. Let's look at our histogram of A, and we saw that in the previous section we could use 10, and that was a fair histogram to make out of this. All right, so that was the histogram that came, just kind of the general one. So we do see around the mean value, we do have more density or more values that are near the mean, and as we get further from the mean, we get fewer and fewer of our data points lying in those bins. So it has at least that general trend we see with normal distributions that we don't see with something like a uniform distribution, or if we have a lot of data near the endpoints and not as much in the middle. So it has very generally that trend of being looking normally distributed. So here, if we go to this data and we put it in the Lilly test, again, our rough estimate as to are we allowed to treat this as as coming from a normal distribution. If I run this, again, I get an H of 0, I get a p-value above 0.05. So according to the Lilliefors test, it would be okay to treat this as coming from a normal distribution. It does not look as good, going back to the what we had back here. It doesn't have that same kind of quintessential bell shape that this relatively to that does, but according to the Lilliefors test, it would be fair to treat it as normally distributed, that data in vector A. Now, going back to the answer data, let's just do a little bit more investigation with that. So we saw that stature appears to be normally distributed. Let's see those other values that we have in here, foot length, ear length, head circumference, things like that. Let me look at head circumference. So that's going to be column E going back here. So if I look at head, I want to take the values from E2 to E1775. And now for my histogram, I want to use that head circumference data instead. And then the rest of this is going to be, well, let me preserve this down here. That's supplying my head circumference. Again, visually, it looks pretty well normally distributed. We have a lot near the mean, and then it tapers off towards what we call the tails, the low end, and the high end. So it would be fair, and running a Lilly test, we should get also an H value of 0 here, that it should be fair to treat head circumference as coming from a normal distribution. However, when we run the Lilly test here, we actually get an H value of 1. It actually does not pass the Lilliefors test. It's saying that we should not be treating this as a normal distribution. So we don't want to rely on the visuals alone to determine is it fair to treat something as normally distributed. So in this case, it failed the Lilliefors test, even though it does kind of look like it's normally distributed. Let's look at another value. Let's look at something like foot length. So that's column C. Reading our foot length data. Doing the same type of analysis here. Now looking at foot length. Making its histogram, its normalized histogram. Okay, so we see the foot length here. Again, it could appear to be normally distributed, but to check that, we put into our test. And we see here, it does not pass the test. That it would not be fair to treat this as being normally distributed. Right, lastly, let's look at the forearm to hand length as our last test here. I'll ignore ear length for this example. So the distance between your forearm plus your hand length is what this measurement was. And this was our column B. And if we look at the histogram for this, we see our forearm length, again, general trend, but to check, can we use this or not? Putting it into our test. Here again, it fails the test. We cannot treat this as being normally distributed. So in summary, we want to look at first the visual, does it even appear like it could be normally distributed? But before we can make that determination if we can treat it as being normally distributed or not, we're going to be using the Lilliefors test, and we can look at the H value and the P value to see is it fair or is it reasonable to treat it as though it comes from a normal distribution. And if it does, then we can use such features as that norm CDF to make predictions of what percentage of the total population is going to be below or above certain values, like we did with the stature. But that would probably not be fair to use for that head circumference, the foot length, or the forearm length.